thanks for joining us. Today, Jennifer Clymer will do an invocation in remembrance of the beloved Joe Sutton. Jennifer?
This is Let Evening Come. Let the light of late afternoon shine through chinks in the barn, moving up the bales as the sun moves down. Let the cricket take up chafing as a woman takes up her needles and her yarn. Let evening come. Let dew collect on the hoe abandoned in the long grass. Let the stars appear and the moon disclose her silver horn. Let the fox go back to its sandy den. Let the wind die down. Let the shed go black inside. Let evening come. To the bottle in the ditch, to the scoop in the oats, to the air in the lung, let evening come. Let it come as it will, and don't be afraid. God does not leave us comfortless, so let evening come.
That was beautiful. Thank you, Jennifer. That was written by Jane Kenyon. Thank you, and I've been sitting here waiting. I feel like an airplane is getting ready to take off with Pam and Michael on the show today. Our first reader was Pam Ward. L.A. native Pam.
L.A. native Pam.
Pam Ward's first
Pam
novel.
Ward's first novel.
I'm not sure where that's coming from, but Want Some, Get Some.
Some, Get Some.
Kensington Chronicles, Los Angeles after the 92 riots. Her second novel, Bad Girls Burn Slow, Kensington, follows a female serial killer. A UCLA graduate and recipient of a California Arts Council Fellow and a Pushcart nomination for poetry, Pam edited the first journal of Los Angeles Black women poets entitled The Supergirl Handbook. She operates a design studio and runs a community press called Short Dress Press. Merging writing and graphics, Pam produced My Life LA, documenting Black Angelenos in poster stories. Pam has published in Calix, Black Renaissance, Voices from Lamart Park, Chiron, and the LA Times. Pam Ward's poetry enraptures me. I fall in love with it and moved by its tragedies, touched by its tenderness and love, soothed by its eloquent language. Her language is authentic, precise, sensuous, and vibrant. A brilliant poet. Here's Pam Ward.
Hi, I hope you can hear me.
Yep.
Okay, good. This poem is from my dad. It's called The Black Architect. God, it's so weird to sit. I'm usually standing. I grew up entrenched in all that was beautiful and black, where afros stood as tall as buildings and fought back the breeze, living in the 60s with frisbees and hula hoop dreams, spinning around my daddy, trying to study his stride, trying to see what lay inside his big size 14s, a walking heart attack of hot-blooded love. I hung on his non-slave tongue. See, my father wasn't no kowtow, no greasy smiling knee dance doing teas. No, my father was more a crowbar, an architect in a neighborhood where nobody even knew what that was. Had a white boy job when black men didn't mean spit. Told us to never be anything less than black, proud black, brown black, snowed a crow black. He knew it wasn't about skin tone, because black burned within. Each artery and vein screamed, never apologized, never hide, never longed for or lusted after or tried to be less. Our consciences never got pressed. Our pride was not conk. We were barbershop black, magnificent brothers black. On a Saturday black, snip snap, where afros emerged to perfection black, Watts Festival black, marching band black, booty shaking, daddy saying, oh my God, black. hot fudge sundae black, sneak in the movie black, steal a lawnmower, daddy made us bring it back black, high tops running in a pack black, hide and go seek black, engine, engine number 9 going down Chicago line, if the train should jump the track, all we ever was black, might have been liquor store black, could have been crackhead black, but we had razor strap. Get away from that. Didn't I tell you not to touch that black? In your ass black. But we loved him back, because we had Al Green and Aretha in our living room black, Watts Prophets black, Eric Priestley black, poetry pounding like drum beats, reminding me to stay up, stay strong. And when the shit got rough, we were pushing right back. Black Panther black, fully strapped, beret wearing, leather jack black. We was wilding then black, talking back black. Don't bring that bullshit or we'll burn it up black. Watts Riots, Rodney King black. Each kneecap, each step speaks. Florence and Normandy storms. Jefferson and Western rain. 60th and Main, where Mama moved after Watts, hopscotch all over our tongue, chicken bob through our neck. I speak black, keep my slang seeped in Mississippi and 99th Street pain. Midnight spat, always beautiful black. White folks try to pantomime. Can't never get it right. Selling Pepsi with our pigmentation as if pig Latin could ever be French. Trying to be spooked so bad some Halloween their skin. But black is within. No copycat can ever take what shines deep inside. What beams like a Slauson and Hoover sun. 103rd Street star. A galaxy of Central Avenue jazz. You could eat a million chicken and waffles and never taste the sweet black that's lodged deep in the Brillo pad of your lungs, that dances across your mane, that cha-chas against your heart, that soothes like a satin lining in a world of itchy wool-faced fools. They will never know the slave ships, the ocean bones of our cousins crying, weeping in their deep sardine graves, floating from Nickerson Garden all the way back to the Ivory Coast. But my dad made me know, kept a library in the hallway of who I was. I saw my father sitting in his black chair every night, the one we could never touch. Kinky hair illuminated in the bulb, reading, always reading, Stokey Carmichael, Kwame Ture, W.E.B. Mommy told me to kiss goodnight, but I'm afraid because he's holding black rage against his chest, ripping through each page, dog-eared from his fingertips. I go in like a drowned kid facing a wave, peck his cheek because daddy loved. And I begin to read everything daddy puts down, even before the words felt good in my brain. Cause all I knew then was Dick and Jane and popsicle blood on my shoe, learning daddy like a foreign language, trying to imitate his abstract tongue, trying to understand his rage that could ignite on a Saturday cartoon June, holding his fist like a knot, not because he didn't love us, but because he tried to keep the horror from our house, the crossburn nights, the billy club moons, the snake pit smile of those who wouldn't give daddy his due because they thought black skin meant he didn't deserve squat and would have shot them in a midnight minute if they could have gotten away clean. But he kept on building, kept sculpting, kept masons pouring cement, kept sealing them cracks, sculpting wood, steel, and dirt into roof, floors, and walls, creating artwork where people birth babies and breathe, making structures, making homes out of slide rules and sludge. But his best work by far was his four kids. Strong black, bold black, we stand as pillars to who he was. Everything that Watts is, as tall as those towers, as colorful as the art, as luminous as the Watts Library daddy designed, beautiful as a Mingus rift, bold as a Sanchez line, blowing wind into the building blocks of our spine, wearing our black like a helmet or a bulletproof vest to protect us, to keep our sweet essence alive, so we can walk in a room and not feel annihilated by fear or shame, because inside you're a fortress, a steel pole or a wall, an architect's daughter with a 12-story heart, raging hot, riding shotgun, ready to wreck shop at a given moment, remembering Molotovs and lynch mobs and streets blazed in heat, because Watts is my father, the birth home of my mom. It's a rhythm, a blazing fire, a rock inside your palm, keeping the beat, keeping the blood, keeping our history alive, as beautiful as new asphalt, as black as an eggplant sky, laying foundations one brick at a time. Ooh, thank you. I never read that one because it's so long. Okay. So my next one is moving right along. Baton lessons. I took 2 baton lessons and quit, leaving the metal rod next to the ice skates and bike I already abandoned for good. It wasn't until Leslie moved next door that I used it again. Leslie liked to talk shit, popped her gum in my face, splattering her slob on my neck. But one day I snapped, ran home, grabbed my baton, got in my pink tights and glitter top, walked back outside and whopped her right there on the sidewalk. I remember gripping it exactly the way I'd seen Willie Mays, then twirling it like in a parade. Mom made me apologize that time, dragging me down to her house, talking about stones and sticks. But secretly, I was proud she'd gotten me those lessons. You never know what tricks come in handy. Thank you. Seems so weird to be reading in a vacuum and no sound. But that's okay. That's okay. Okay, kids, here we go. Election's coming up, so this is one for a president. It's called The Yellow Children of Monticello. My cousins are descendants from Sally Hemings and Thomas Jefferson. Before Roosevelt, way before JFK, before Clinton claimed I did not have sex on TV, before Monica Lewinsky tripped out and forgot to wash that dress, Thomas Jefferson was banging out tots like a fiend, making a banquet out of Sally Hemings' body. He created more kids than he could track. Jefferson kept his black children under lock and key, all while singing, "Oh, Say Can We See." All his pickaninnies, tall and skinny, looked exactly like him. And nobody blinked. Nobody batted a lash. Seeing these yellow children of Monticello springing everywhere like weeds, they heard Thomas Jefferson's cry of freedom turn to bedroom deceits. They watched their father, a boll weevil, feast on fresh draws like a cotton gin, separating seeds. And when they realized he would never, 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 never set them free, they read his Declaration of Independence. They waited for a harmony of coughs. They watched this apostle of the Constitution and willed bronchitis to drum his lungs. They sang hymns to bring on fever, yearn for heart attacks or strokes, anything to take his last breath. But Jefferson lived and lived and lived and lived and lived and lived and lived. He did, the motherfucker lived to like 90-something. "We hold these truths to be self-evident," he said. For his yellow kids, these were just a long-winded speech. People applauded. People lauded him a saint. People ignored his children in chains. Only when slavery began its swan dance, unraveling like a hymn, did Jefferson finally relent. At last, on his deathbed, before he peacefully died in his sleep. Jefferson and Sally Hemings' kids were finally released. But wait a minute. Stop the presses. Maybe it didn't happen like that at all. Maybe Sally got fed up with all the laundry, sex, and lies. Sick of the broken promises, maybe Sally finally snapped like an overseer whipping a child's back. Maybe Sally had to go all Monica on them all. She wouldn't be the first to topple a president. Plantation life takes its toll. So maybe Sally took out Jefferson herself, having that one final pillow talk at last. Thank you very much. Okay, let's see. Here we go. Oh, we're in Hollywood. Should we do some Hollywood poem? We could do a Hollywood poem. Hollywood sign. The Hollywood sign. Each day I leave home, I see the Hollywood sign. Straight up 6, underneath Venice, after a quick costume switch where Rossmayer turns to the cement stars on Vine, where the lip of ambition is a gum wrapper now, a black sticky mouth on the base of a shoe is the only speaking part some folks ever know. Hollywood greets me daily. It teases my fate. Makes me think of Grandpa playing in Beretta, telling me Robert Blake's the nicest guy, but definitely the type to off his wife. And how easily the scene could change in my own living room if Grandma didn't stand up and put her foot down when Grandpa tripped and almost ran off with Dorothy Dandridge. The sign, bright and clean, yells the word Hollywood at my car. A command, a gnar curse, a drill sergeant barking at Marines, smacking me silly, yelling at me, hey, stand up straight. A verbal checkpoint Charlie, a literary Star Trek fleet, holding the porn industry from seeping back into LA with only 9 letters, a few nicks from sky. Hollywood laughs, Hollywood winks, bathes me in white popcorn lies, watches me race just like OJ on action-packed streets, watches me swerve, watches me streak, watches my savage life go by, gripping my coffee between my knees, wearing my work clothes like a disguise, trying not to use my life around blow-up doll curves, drivers who are clockwork orange mean, and Christopher Reeve making bets from my spine. Hollywood, the sign screams, casting away Cape Fears or Boogie Nights. It sees Charlie Sheen winning, Spike Lee doing the right thing. Hollywood like you should, the giant billboard sings, a burglar alarm, a high-pitched whistle, the kind only heard by dogs, calling all bitches and broke-down punks and even drama queens like me. Wearing my sunglasses like a smirk, eating Doritos nacho cheese, where an empty gas tank is the only comedy I know. And even if I fall in a pothole and forget all my lines, or I'm beaten within an inch of my life like Rodney King, and my Hollywood, a bottle of nail polish, spills like blood on my thigh, a slasher flick, a chainsaw massacre, fading like Black Dahlia wine, turning into a two-part cocktail mix of the word. Holly, toxic berry. Wood, splintered tree. Making me as queasy as a Catalina boat ride. All I do is look up and see your giant gate mouth smile, munching a bonbon, sipping some vodka, handing me another red vine dream, doing your Hollywood shuffle between drought-ridden trees. You sneak in the way I used to sneak in Grauman's Chinese, quiet as a vial of Botox, firm as a policeman's jaw. Tucking me down, telling me take it easy, handing me a map to the stars. You stand like Godzilla, the last scene in King Kong, Shirley MacLaine screaming, just give her the fucking shot. your 40-foot landmark, a single word speech, an omen, a playlist, a ventriloquist on speed, teaching a galaxy of stars how to shine. Hollywood props me up, pushes a toothpick between my teeth, hands me a script and a pair of ruby rhinestones pumps, whispers to me like Dorothy before she leaves Oz, reminding me of all LA is, from Kunta Kinte to Bruce Lee, from Florence and Normandy homies to racist cops speeding back to see me. Hollywood shines strobe light pink, gives me a second callback time, and reminds me there's no place like home. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, I don't know where my time is, but I think I'm good for maybe a few shorties. Okay, how about this? I remember reading this when Eve Brandstein and Michael Lally had this great spot on, was it La Cienega? Lavely or something? Wait, you know what it's called. Mike, Lally knows. Great. What was
it? You're talking about Largo?
Yes, I love that place. Place was hot. Okay, so exhaust. She detested it. Right down to the ride up there, counting Denny signs and cars broke down, the fake Aztec look of the suburbs. It reminded her of thin, see-through curtains, chip-rotten tile, that smoky, dead smell of motel rooms. And why she left them for good, she thought that time. All the busted-up plates, the stacks of ripped pictures, her good dresses shoved in the trash can. Howie called her again and again till she finally picked up, his voice in one smog oozing plea. And the only thing worse, the only thing worse than that dry separation was being with him now on this hot vinyl seat on another long ride to his mother's. Thank you.
Pam, we have 2 minutes left. So in that
Okay, good. I'll get this one last in. I just have to do it for Planned Parenthood because I'm trying to pull rights from women. It'll take me 90 seconds. Love poem to Paul Hill. All right, so okay. So you want to get funky. Got your panties all bunched and your dick feels big and your prayer books are feeling like bricks now. So you bad. You can walk in and blast a whole clinic. Because you even think God's got your back. Preaching righteous all night about the value of life, plant some bombs and kill 15 by lunchtime. You ain't pro-life, you low-life. But check the score, son. We won, owned and claimed it in Roe versus Wade. You're just pissed because we won't give it back. So go home, pull your tampon out, lick your bones solo, take a my dog douche or your, a nap. Get your hands off my crotch. Get your lips from my oven. Get your anti-choice murderous ass out my house. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. I'm sorry, Pam. I didn't mean to interrupt you, but
I tried to time it.
You were perfect. I want to just ask you, in the minute we have left before Michael comes on, when did you write your first poem?
Probably when I was in elementary school. I was always writing. I used to take the inside of my mother's pantyhose pack, it was a nice slick piece of cardboard, fold it in half, and I would make greeting cards with the poems out of it. So, yeah.
What is it about poetry that attracts you?
I like the shorthand version of poetry, how it condenses life into like the nut kernel essence of what a thing is. And even though I've written novels, I come back to poetry so that I can say the thing with a punch and create a feeling, a smell, a sound with just a minimal amount of words.
That's wonderful. And thank you for your wonderful reading. It's always a rare pleasure to hear you and see you in person. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you. I'm waiting for Michael. I can't wait to hear you, Mike.
We'll see.
A former jazz musician, Hollywood actor, and radical organizer. The New Jersey-born Michael Lally is the author of over 30 books of poetry and prose, including the acclaimed Swing Theory, 2015, and Another Way to Play Poems, 1960 to 2017, which I love. He is a recipient of the Penn Oakland Josephine Miles Award for Excellence in Literature and grants from the National Endowment for the Arts, among others. Michael Lally has the ability to enter your soul with his words and take you with him as he weaves his narrative. His narrative has great strength, lucidity of reason, a precise beat and harmony. In his poems, I find a toughness, love and loss, humility, grace, and generosity. A luminous poet, Michael Lally.
Thank you so much, Harry. I always like to start with a poem I haven't read before. So this was posted online in recent weeks. It's called An Old Man Looks Back on His Looks with No Remorse. At certain times in my life, I was a handsome man. At other times, a very goofy-looking man, a plain-looking man, or an odd-looking man. I was at times an Irish-looking man and a white-looking man. I often looked younger, but at times passed for older. When asked by the director of an indie movie to play a coked-up suicidal rabbi in it, I said, with this Irish mug? And he said, the rabbi who taught me for my bar mitzvah looked exactly like you. Several times I passed for black in situations, especially in the then legally segregated South, where pale black folks sometimes passed for white and sometimes passed for black. And identity seemed to be dependent on something like mass delusion. I've been the same weight, give or take a few pounds, since I was 15, except for a few years around age 50, when I worked out with a trainer and bulked up with muscles that made me feel like somebody else. So I went back to my old self and weight. Though as I grew older, that weight seemed to move around, like from my shoulders and chest to my belly. These days, as I move into my 80s, as I'm heading for my 80s, I seem to have acquired the looks of a generic old white man, indistinguishable from other old white men, at least to those who don't fit into that category, though those of us who do can see the more subtle differences. I could be part Jewish or Italian or Brazilian or African or indigenous or trans or queer or lots of things you might not think I could be by my appearance. But what seems to matter most to many I encounter when out in public is that I appear to be a generic old white man. And from that, there seems to come conclusions I might disagree with. But recognize there's no point in doing so. Minds have been made up in most cases, and any words or gestures or styles or ways I can look will not change those conclusions, as happens to so many others. So that's that one. I'm reading it off the computer, so now I can't see you guys. This one is from the 60s, and it's also about my father. I have two poems about my father to echo Pam's, or resonate maybe. This was called Hard Rain, wrote in the 60s when I was in my 20s. Bob Dylan, the Fat Pack Pussycat, same way my father met my mom, working. We was always working. If we woke up sick and complained, father'd say, eat some breakfast, then get a little exercise, working. If one of us met a girl and started stuttering, sure. Coming out of the Pacific, met Buddy Holly, soaking wet. You look like me with your glasses on, he said. I don't wear no glasses, I said. My father wouldn't like it. Try to see me, he said. Sure. Working comes close to praying where I come from. My father used to say three things, work, work, work. Some people are like that. I told my mom, God rest her soul, there's a Rangoon in Illinois you ain't heard of. Place to go for tattoos so people know who you are. Met Alan Ladd there. Told me to go home. Go home, boy, he said. Get yourself a job. Get yourself a father, I said. Where am I, I said. Rest your soul, I said. Work, I said. Work, work. Sure. So that's them. Now I'm going to read a poem that's a little long, also in homage to Pam, I guess, and her one about her father, but mostly for Harry. I usually read this at the beginning of the baseball season, and coincidentally, it's the beginning of the baseball season, because I stopped watching baseball much when the Dodgers left Brooklyn. It broke my heart, but I know Harry was a baseball player, so I wanted to read this for him, although I'm sure he's heard me read it before. It's called Sports Heroes, Cops, and Lace, which was a theme even I came up with one week for that Largo reading, and this is what came out of it. Let me take a quick sip of water. As you can tell, my voice is gonna be less and less able to do this. Part of the aging thing. Anyway, here's a poem. Jackie Robinson was my first real sports hero, my first real hero, period. My father once took me to see Jersey Joe Walcott work out for one of his fights. It was in a summer camp in the North Jersey Hills. We called them mountains back then. Jersey Joe was already getting old, but he was game and carried himself like a champ. I even got introduced to him by my father's friend. And I remember how nice he was. In fact, I was struck by his openness and friendliness and unexpected gentleness when it was obvious he could have easily killed anybody there with his bare hands if he felt like it. My father was a sporting man. He played the ponies every day and knew everybody at the track and even made a little book on the side. We always watched the Friday night fights together on the old console black and white TV. The Gillette song, and that announced it with a high nasal voice. And my father leaning out of his chair, already an old man to me, but sporty, with what seemed like closets full of sporting shoes and sport coats. He probably had two or three pair, but as a little kid, right? We only had one closet, but in my mind, it seemed like closets. And even a camel's hair overcoat I used to sneak a feel of every time I went into the hall closet. He'd point out Jake LaMotta, call him the possum because he could play dead. Let a man batter him for what seemed like hours, and then when the opponent dropped his car, tear him apart. He had heart, it was said. But all these guys seemed somehow tarnished to me. Even Jersey Joe, they were like my father's friends, nice enough guys who always treated me right. Even if I hated that they called me Little Jimmy, I told them my name is Michael. So then they called me Mikey, but they were okay. Even the ones who were obvious bums, like Boots and Mary and Frenchie, and all these characters my father had grown up with and run with and continued to help out till the day he died. It was like living inside a Damon Runyon story, and I dug the romance of it, because despite the idea people usually have who have never lived that life, it is romantic. In fact, that's one of the appeals of that world, any kind of underworld, the bookies, the petty crooks, and over-the-hill champs. There was a glamour and a romance there, even with the old bags and bums like Boots and Mary. Hey, I used to see them holding hands as they searched the ground for butts. But it wasn't until Jackie Robinson entered the big leagues that I found a hero of my own. The man had something more than the romance of the streets and sporting life. And my father's friends and closets of my home. The man had what my father feared and desired most, class. The thing my father's friends would toast him for. And it was true that in our neighborhood, my father had some class and carried it as best he could. But in the face of people more comfortable in this world and self-assured, my father would get awful humble and almost do a kind of white man shuffle that made me feel that maybe I wasn't good enough either. he'd pretend that we were better off where we were and among our own kind. And we all grew up believing that other Americans, the ones whose families have been here for a long time, whose kids went to college, and whose fathers and uncles ran the businesses that really mattered, we were taught they weren't as happy as we thought we were, especially when we partied or married or someone died. But inside, I knew it wasn't pride. It was some unacknowledged form of ambition suicide. Don't think beyond these streets, these ways of being, or you might get hurt. We knew our place. And then Jackie Robinson entered Major League Baseball as the first of his race. And I saw a kind of dignity in the face of the obscenities that greeted him every day on the field. And it made my chest swell with pride, which didn't make any sense since I was obviously white and knew nothing about this man, except that he could stand up to the lowest forms of hatred and not let it affect him, at least in not any way I could see. And I saw a model for me when the kids would do the cruel things kids can sometimes do. I would think of Jackie Robinson, and I would try to be heroic like him, and sometimes it worked. And when they called me a jerk and a race traitor and all the rest, because when we played stickball and each took on the persona of our favorite players, I would pick him and the other white kids would berate me and try to get me to react the way I usually do with my fist or my murder mouth, or something that could be turned to their amusement as long as I was out of control. But when I took on his name for this game, it took on his dignity too, and it got me through their petty prejudices and opened up the whole new world. Sometimes it even worked with the girls, until they too began to feel compelled to make fun of one of their race who was inspired by a man whose face was handsome and intense, but happened to be denser in its reflection of the sun than one of us. Jackie Robinson was a guide to the outside world for me. His example let me see that what I was taught was not necessarily true, and what I always suspected I knew might be. He gave me a way to go beyond that world and to go deeper into me. And when I came back, what I learned helped me to see that even the people I had left behind knew these things too. When my cop brother and my cop brother-in-law and my cop uncle and cousin and boarder in my mother's house denounced the riots in the 60s, always in racist tones, I confront them about their black friends they often had in their homes. And they would say, "That's different, that's LJ, he's my friend, he's not one of them." But when I point out how they often dressed and spoke and drove the same cars and hung out in the same bars and all the rest, they'd get hurt, like I had turned into some kind of foreigners, one of those old-time Americans who didn't understand and tried to grandstand with their liberal ideas when they lived in wealthy enclaves and never had to deal with the reality of our streets. They tell me they didn't think they'd ever meet one of their own kind as blind or as real as me. And then they try and make me see that they didn't have anything against the Jews and blacks and Italians and homos and even the rich, because they all had friends or even in-laws that fit those labels. They try to tell me it's about being true to who you really are, no matter how far your people have come or haven't come. And then they tell some story about how it used to be. And then they ask me, how come I never wrote those Damon Runyon stories about them? Or more importantly, about my father. They figured I didn't bother because I got too far away from what I'd been. When I moved away from the old neighborhood after my father said I was no good for wanting to marry a black girl and having too many black friends. And then when I finally came back again so many years after I left him, this time we didn't fight. Because I asked him about Boots and Mary, whatever happened to Louie the Lip or Two-Ton Tony. He talked all night and it finally felt all right with him. He talked about how his mother had been a live-out maid when he was a kid. We never talked about politics or the division that had driven us all into fear and insecurity. I listened, he talked, and after I left, he called me up and asked if I had enough to get my kids Christmas presents this year. I said I did. I never took a dime from them before. Why should I start now? One of my sisters called and told me because because it was the only way he could say because it was the only way he could say I love you. So I called him back and said, hey, I could use 200. Sorry. This is poem always gets me. And he said, it's yours. And I took the kids to see him with the gifts of his money were possible. He was watching sports on TV. And all of a sudden he brought up Jackie Robinson, how he always admired that man's dignity. And a few days later he called up the only brother he had left and told him to take him to the hospital. The doctor called my sister and told her, there's nothing we can find, we'll keep him overnight and send him home. And of course he died. And this time when they tried to bring him back, he refused. And I don't know why he wanted to die, that was a lot of years ago. All I know is when I saw Field of Dreams, I started to cry. I didn't even know why. My father and I never even tried to play any game. But hey, you know? I'm not ashamed to carry his name. Carry his name. I hope he feels the same. Sorry, guys. The older I get, the more weepy I get. You know, it's crazy. Thank you. Yeah, that just gets me every time. I live about a block or so, not a block or so, but a few blocks from where I grew up now. I never planned to come back here, but I did. And the ghost of my father haunts me daily. And I appreciate him so much more. A seventh grade dropout immigrant kid who had seven kids, took care of people, took care of the whole family, took care of his brothers and sisters. He was a cool guy in here. All right, let me see if I can find. This poem. This is crazy doing off the internet. I'm actually feeling like techno savvy for the first time in my life. I usually feel what I call techno dyslexic. This is part of a long poem. I'm just going to read a part of it. And some of you may have heard this before too. It's one of my favorites. I was hired, oddly enough. A guy heard me read my poetry and give a lecture about ethnicity and race and stuff. And an ethical culture society had asked me to do it. And he was an arthritis doctor. And he was in charge of organizing their yearly luncheon. And he asked me to come and read a poem to the luncheon. So I wrote a poem about arthritis and read it to this luncheon. Got a good fee. It was pretty cool. So this is a little section of it. After I talk about people in my family, my Irish immigrant grandfather and my father and so on. And then I talk about this. The only encounters I had with arthritis outside the above were when I made my first movie with a Hollywood star whose hands were so gnarled it looked like mushrooms grew wild under his pale skin. John Carradine played my character's grandfather and still had the force of all the roles I'd seen him play since I was a boy as he stared at me from behind the camera while I prepared for my close-up at his supposed deathbed and the director leaned in to whisper in my ear he'd like to see some tears on my face and yelled, action, and I panicked, thinking I'm not good enough to cry on cue. But John Carradine stared into my eyes with the intensity of his, and as I looked away in search of an alternative, I saw his hands, those knuckles erupting under his skin with fierce independence, like an alternative artwork of organic confusion blossoming into fingers that extended in every direction, uncontrollably bent and stiffened and askew. And the tears flew from my eyes, much to my surprise, and the rest of the cast and crew, who after cut was shouted, erupted in spontaneous applause. but none from John Carradine, who couldn't have clapped if he wanted to. He just kept looking into my eyes as he nodded his head in approval and smiled slyly. That was wonderful getting to work with him. He would be like this, you know, he'd say, I see 5 minutes, thank you. Was that right, 5 minutes?
10 minutes.
Oh, 10 minutes, okay, yeah. I got one more poem. But he was great because he was such an example. He'd be totally out of it. He was old and gnarly and he'd get full of difficulties. He'd be totally out of it or nodding or whatever. And they would say, actually, he'd be like, oh, the whole, cut. It was brilliant to watch. Okay, this last one I'm going to read is another sort of a new favorite for others and for myself. Another aging poem called Love Never Dies. Lots of shit dies. Love doesn't. Parts of me are already dead, but love isn't. My appendix, dead and buried. My prostate and a disc from my back, dead and gone too. And parts of my brain, cut out with the dime-sized fallen body. I got in there somehow, it caused so much trouble. The Twin Towers died, and all those lost with them. Like a woman who was kind to me when she didn't have to be. Gone on one of those two planes, but my love for her isn't. 5 of my siblings and our old man and Ma passed on now for a while. Not the love we shared when we were honest. The mother of my oldest kids, my first wife, gone. But the love she and I shared never died. So maybe the like did. My first true love, too, the love of my life, gone now for almost a decade. But my love for her and hers for me never died. Even through all of our husbands and wives and lovers over the years when we were out of touch with each other, none of that stopped the love we both felt and affirmed whenever we spoke again, like the week before she passed, still working to help troubled kids find families. Those kids still grateful for the love she showed them and still alive, even if she's with the ancestors now. Or other women I've lived with who have passed on, or lovers long gone, like Joan B. or Joe B. Her face so sweet and tough, voice still admonishing me to just be myself and not worry what others think. His voice so quiet and stuttering in my ear as I write this. His image on my bookshelves with his books. His art on my walls. I only wished he'd lived long enough to see it didn't matter how famous he did or didn't become. His work living on among us who love it, exhibited often since he passed. Or Tony, gone so recently, a young man who went from ripping doors off their hinges when he was upset with his wife and kids to the gentlest giant of many I've known. His skinhead rages transformed as he turned the pages of his life from anger to compassion, his punk Buddhist practice enabling him to live with the rare brain disease that took his physical presence from us, but not the love we who knew him shared. I think of him every day, I think of him every day as I do a lot who live now only in our hearts. Oh, lots of shit dies, like almost everything that was new when I was a boy, including the people. If you live long enough, so much passes it feels like another world, but it's the same one, where love never dies. That's what I had planned, Harry.
Michael, you know, listening and seeing Pam and you read, I mean, it's a rare pleasure, and it just I can't think of anybody who's ever done anything better than you two. You guys are just, this reminds me why poetry is such a great art. It's just the most fascinating and captivating form. There is just one person telling her or his story and gathering you in. And it just, you know, takes me back, you know, to Homer, you know, sitting around the fire, telling those stories over and over again. But you guys are incredible. Thank you. And before we go, we have about 4 or 5 minutes left. Michael, could you just talk? You've had, you graduated from Iowa University. You taught college. You presented poetry readings. You've had so many exceptional poetry readings in your life. Just tell me a little bit, all of us, a little bit about when did you write your first poem and why is poetry important to you?
I wrote my first poem, it's in my archives at NYU Library. It's I was about 4 or 5. I started writing pretty early. I was the youngest of 7. One died as an infant before me, and my mother would talk to me about it. My sisters and brothers, when I'd mention it, they'd go, "What? Oh yeah, yeah, I remember that vaguely." But because I was a little boy, and my mother had just lost this other little boy before me, and I was home with her, you know, she would share that. And his presence felt like, you know, a part of my life. So I was trying to compete with all these older siblings. And also, as I mentioned, my mother's mother came to live with us when I was about 3. A great aunt lived with us for a while. Irish immigrants would come and stay with us. A border, a cop, and my father was a friend of my father's from his youth, moved in for a while and stayed till he died. So he was the border and, you know, all these brothers and sisters. So I'm a kid. And then we had a whole block full of cousins and so on. So I was constantly trying. I felt this tremendous drive I could remember trying to talk before I could talk and standing in my crib and going, blah, 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 and they'd be talking to me, blah, 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 I can't wait till you can fucking understand me. I got so much to say. And so, you know, but I couldn't find compatriots, you know, like people that seemed to have what was in my mind, seemed to understand me. And I became a voracious reader as a kid, and poetry was the first place I started finding people that were saying things or communicating things that I could identify with and gave me relief. I always like to say poetry saved my life, Harry, because I feel like it did. My two nicknames when I was a boy were Faggy and Rocky. And I was such a weird, I'm still weird, you know. And I tried to, you know, I hid it most of my life and one persona or another, but I was just all over the place. I was often, people say, you know, you got to take them to a shrink, and, you know, all that stuff. I was often just in trouble for being crazy. And so I found my fellow craziness, you know, my crazy people in poetry, in the poems, in the poets. The first one that struck me, I read everything in the back of the church. Back in the 50s, those of us who are old enough to remember, paperbacks were everywhere. They were like ubiquitous. And my father's little home repair business across the street was a cigar store. And the guy who ran it, he had a pocket paperback thing. And he would let me borrow them if I bought them back. So I wouldn't, I'm running out of time. Anyway, yeah, I read voraciously and it saved my life. Still does.
Thank you, Michael. I love your poetry. I love your poetry, Pam. This is really a memorable, captivating experience for me. You just brought tears to my eyes and the music. You don't need no instruments, no musical instruments when you two are on. You guys are the music. But thank you, and it's time now. Thank you all for joining us, and it's time now to return this to our wonderful, fabulous Jennifer Clymer.
Love to you guys.